because it's good to be put to mind of, it's good to be set into the mood of the fulfillment of all our hopes. Come the glorious dawning of Easter, number 7 days from that. We hope that the songs we're going to sing, that the narration we're going to hear, is going to lift your spirits and focus your hearts and minds on the journey of this coming Holy Week. We're honored to present this cantata to you and pray it will aid you in your journey of hope in the coming week. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we give you thanks and praise for all the blessings of this day. We're reminded of how wonderful our gathering was here this morning. Reminded of the great joy of processing down to the center aisle with children and choirs. We're reminded of the wonderful sounds, wonderful message of Palm Sunday. Father, we pray that you continue to touch us, continue to move us in this time together here this evening. Lord, send your Spirit to us, move your Spirit among us, that we join our Lord Jesus Christ, that we be found close in his shadow, close in his footsteps, in this great journey of hope, this coming Holy Week. We ask you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, in order to preserve the solemnity of the Lenten season and this evening's cantata, the choirs ask that you please refrain from applauding both during and after the program. The choirs will gather both in the narthex and downstairs in the lobby for you to talk to them, ask them questions, or just generally congratulate them on a wonderful program, which I'm sure you will enjoy. Thank you.
Beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God.
In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" Jesus replied, "Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness." As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once, they left their nets and followed him.
In all, Jesus called to his ministry 12 disciples. Following in faith, they walked beside him throughout his travels. They beheld miracles and wonders, and he began to teach them a new way. In time, nearly all would be martyred for their faith. Through loneliness and rejection, persecution, and even unto death, they followed on, choosing Jesus over all.
I want Jesus.
Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. When Jesus saw the people, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. So he began leading them and teaching them many wonderful things.
Come to me, all who are labored and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
To draw great multitudes wherever he went. His reputation as a healer and teacher had grown throughout the land. After Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, the chief priests began to plot to kill him, for many of the Jews were believing in him. When Jesus and his chosen ones approached Jerusalem, many gathered palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and blessed is the King of Israel." His triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and as the time for Passover drew near, Jesus began to prepare his disciples for the Passover feast. Jesus knew the time was near for him to leave this world and to go to the Father. They all gathered in an upper room and shared the evening meal together. During the meal, Jesus revealed more of his mission to the 12. To the amazement of the disciples, the teacher wrapped a towel around his waist, poured water into a basin, and began to wash their feet.
When he had finished washing their feet, he returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. I have set for you an example that you should do so as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them."
Thank you.
After the Passover meal, Jesus and his disciples moved from the upper room to a nearby garden they had visited many times before. During the cool of the evening, they rested and pondered all that they had experienced. Jesus went ahead of them, deeper into the garden, to pray.
Jesus withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground.
Thank you.
By the glare of blazing torches and the clamor of centurion armor, Jesus was arrested and brought to Pilate's court to face his accusers. Responding to the crowd's cries for crucifixion, Pilate gave the order for Jesus to be executed. The soldiers showed no mercy as they beat him and laid a heavy wooden cross upon his back. Jesus then began the slow and painful climb up to Calvary.
Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of a skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews."
Jesus walked that lonesome valley for me.
The sky grew dark as the sounds of a gruesome crucifixion echoed across the rocky landscape. Even in his final fragile moments of life, Jesus loved those he had come to save. Those final precious phrases reveal a heart of mercy and a message of hope for the world. No words of complaining or condemnation, no words of bitterness or regret, one last expression of love, "Father, forgive them." And grace fell like a gentle rain upon a parched and withered creation, "Father, forgive them." And the garden began to dream once again of life. One last cry, "It is finished." And the journey to hope was made clear, the path cleared of all stones. Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus, our Lamb and our Shepherd, is the journey, and He, the journey's end.
Thank you. Lord.